Welcome to the Ecommerce Marketing Podcast, the highly rated digital marketing podcast that provides weekly digital marketing tips and strategies from some of the world's top digital marketers and e-commerce entrepreneurs that will help you take your digital marketing to the next level. Sit back and enjoy this power-packed episode hosted by Arlen Robinson, who is an e-commerce entrepreneur and digital marketing expert with over 20 years of experience. Hey, e-commerce marketing podcast listener. Are you looking to increase traffic and sales to your website? You can do this by launching your own affiliate program. Just visit getosi.com and sign up for a free trial today. That's getosi.com. Now get ready to hear from your e-commerce marketing expert of the week as they drill down to give you details on marketing strategies that can help grow your business.
Welcome back to the Ecommerce Marketing Podcast, everyone. I am your host, Arlen Robinson, and today we have a very special guest, Shash Singh, who runs Linx Digital Agency, which is an agency that has generated over $30 million in revenue for their clients with YouTube advertising. Shash has worked with clients like Prodigy Game, Kinobody, Amazing, Selling Machine, and more. With multi seven figures under ad spend management, Shash's agency is one of the leading YouTube ad agencies in the game. Welcome to the podcast, Shash.
Thanks for having me on here. I'm excited.
Yes, thank you for joining me. And I'm really excited to talk to you as well. We were just mentioning right before we started recording where how we really are all in this video world. So, you know, YouTube is hotter than ever. And so I know you guys and your team have been really busy lately. And I'm really excited, to talk about our topic for today, which is going to be YouTube advertising specifically for e-commerce brands, because all of these brands these days now, all e-commerce brands are trying to figure out how they can take advantage of all of this traffic that's coming through YouTube, the advertising avenues and channels that are available there. And so I know we're going to be digging deep into that. And but before we do get into that, why don't you tell us a little bit about your background and, you know, specifically how you did get into what you're doing today?
Yes. So I basically started out with YouTube advertising back in 2015, end of the year, when one of my friends, Greg from Kinobody, he wanted help with his YouTube ads. I had never run paid ads at that time. I gave it a shot, expecting me to fail miserably. But within 2 weeks, we're spending $5,000 a day profitably, making 10 to 15 grand a day back. And that's when I realized that, hey, this YouTube ads thing is legitimate. The fact that a complete newbie can go on there and do 5,000 a day in spend without any prior paid ads experience just told me that, okay, there is something here. This is a platform that has a lot of potential. And that was back when, you know, YouTube was still very young and they didn't have many of the tools that they have right now. And as of this point, I think it's a much more developed ecosystem with much better support from Google, with much better targeting options, and as well as options for bidding.
Okay, great, great. Well, that's awesome. So I see that you've kind of been in the game a little while now, as far as, you know, you said, Mark, starting in 2014, helping out your friend. And you're totally right. It has changed quite a bit these days because of the amount of views that YouTube now gets and just the interest and just the amount of content that's available now. So I think Google has done a really great job of, supporting the platform, so to speak, for advertisers. So really where I want to start off with for any newbies or anyone that is just kind of fresh out of the gate looking to get into it, really, what are the different ad options that are available through YouTube advertising?
Yes. So basically there is just so many different options in terms of both targeting and ad formats, right? So in terms of ad formats, the one that we all know of is the in-stream ads, where you're able to skip it after 5 seconds, and it shows up before videos, right? So you're about to watch a video, an ad shows up, you have 5 seconds, you got to wait, and then after that, you can skip it. So that's an in-stream skippable ad. And with that ad format, that's where the majority of our spend is really, you know, that's where we get the most productive views out of our spend. On the other hand, we also have responsive video ads, which can show up in a variety of places like the homepage. It can show up on the side of videos, et cetera. And there's just a huge number of ad format options, but also targeting options. So one of the really great targeting options is custom intent and custom affinity. So you can target people on YouTube based on what they're searching on google.com. So that's something I personally love doing, because we've had amazing success with targeting really broad audiences based off on competitors' URLs. So we will create an audience, a custom audience based off, let's say, a big industry name in the e-commerce space, right? And then we'll run that in for our e-commerce clients, for our clients who are basically selling e-commerce courses. And we've been able to scale that to $5,000 a day based on that one audience. And what Google does is you input that URL, and then Google takes a good guess based on all the massive data they have, right? So they take an educated guess as to who to target based on that URL. So they try to target people who are most similar to the people that go to that URL. So that's basically a custom audience based off affinity, right? Like what website they get into and what websites they visit. So that's something that's incredibly powerful.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely is. And I can bear witness to those type of ads myself. There's been so many times where I've been on Google searching, going to different sites, and then I'm on YouTube. I'm a huge YouTube fanatic. it's hard for me to avoid some of the content on YouTube, as I'm one of the kind of educational people. So I'm always looking for different educational videos about you name it, from space to space flight to aviation, all types of different niches that I'm interested in. And so when I'm going from those searches that I did on Google, and then let's say watching the latest, let's say SpaceX launch, when I'm going over to YouTube, then I will see, you know, some ads that are related to my searches. And yeah, those I think, I guess could also fall into the category of like retargeting. Would you consider that kind of retargeting a user where they're on Google, then they're going on YouTube and they're seeing related ads? Would that be considered a retargeting type of campaign?
I consider anything that's where they have already interacted with your brand and then you target them as retargeting. I wouldn't consider that retargeting, because they're still not introduced to basically your whole brand, right? So let's say they search on google.com best house plants, right? Best house plants, because there's a plant in front of me. And then on YouTube, you get a video ad for your brand's house plants, right? Let's say you guys have the house plant that cleans air better than an air filter and so on. It has all these benefits. At that point, they still haven't been introduced to your brand. So you're basically, you're using intent-based advertising, because you know they have a certain intent, which is they're interested in learning more about house plants. And then you're targeting them on YouTube based on that.
Okay. Got it. That makes sense. So it's not really a direct retargeting, because they didn't actually look at that particular brand site on Google. Their intent was to look up houseplants. And then when you go over to YouTube, you're seeing related. I see what you're saying. So it's kind of like like you said, it's more of an intent-based retargeting, but not specifically retargeting a company. So that makes sense. And yeah, that happens to me a lot all the time when I'm going and I'm seeing those type of intent-based ads that are displayed to me. Now, there are, of course, a lot of different ad options that are available, you know, as you mentioned, and not only on YouTube, but all of these different platforms, from, you know, social media platforms like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, all of these different platforms. And specifically with YouTube, I think one of the questions actually that I think really comes around a lot is, you know, especially if you're in a competitive niche, let's say, a super competitive niche. I know one competitive niche that I'm familiar with, that I think has always been competitive niche, still is today, has been the web hosting space. That's a very competitive niche. And so let's say you're a small hosting brand, you're in that particular niche, and you know, you want to do YouTube advertising. Is it next to impossible to try to get any traction in these hyper-competitive niches like web hosting, or is there things that you can do to still get, you know, kind of the rest of the crumbs that are left on the table? What's your take on that?
So I don't think in this particular case, I don't think it's necessarily about competition. I think it's about the offer. So let me explain that a bit further. There are a lot of ultra competitive niches that we've been very successful in. So for example, some of the most competitive niches on YouTube right now are e-commerce courses, right? Okay. Or let's say finance courses, or anything in that kind of general area where you basically have a million people advertising and the ad costs are super high. Click costs in the e-commerce education niche and the Amazon FBA niche can literally in some accounts be $4 to $5 per click, right? Which is very expensive. Now, the thing is, we've still been wildly profitable in those niches. And the reason for that is it comes down to the offer, where in that niche, you can sell packages, you know, let's say a program for $2,000, $5,000. I've even seen people sell done for you e-commerce services for $20,000, $30,000. So essentially, the customer acquisition cost isn't that difficult to basically deal with, right? Because you're able to just sell them something that's a lot more expensive. Now, in terms of something where it's a recurring fee, like web hosting, where it's $12 a month, you may have some success selling a yearly package or bundling it in with, let's say, a web design package and so on. But if you're selling somebody on a $12 a month package, the issue there is just the fact that your customer acquisition cost is just, it's going to be higher. You might keep them on for 2 years, right? Let's say your average customer, keep them on 3 to 4 years. In many web hosting companies, that's true. But you simply don't have the cash flow to support going 6 months in the hole to acquire a customer that will pay you for, you know, 2.5 years, right? Even though theoretically the long-term ROI would be like 4 or 5X. It's just that most web hosting companies simply don't have the cash flow, while let's say HostGator or some of these larger companies, they have tons of cash. So they will spend like, you know, one year of customer value to get a new customer in, because they know have the customer for 2 or 3 years, right? Mm-hmm. So that's something that's very common with software companies. And the solution to that, in my experience, is you either want to go with some sort of upfront offer where you either bundle in a year, you bundle in some education. What I've seen software companies do really well is basically bundle in a course and a 6 month trial of their software or a 3 month trial of their software. So a great example of this is ClickFunnels. The way they were basically acquiring customers for their software while making a profit is selling a course for $997, bundling in 3 or 6 months of ClickFunnels. And obviously people would renew. And because of the $997 price point, because there will always be a sub niche of your industry that will pay $997, right? It might be 3% of people, but 3% of the people that will buy at $997 is a lot more profitable than 10% of people who will buy at, let's say, you know, $47, right? It's just one of those things where as the price increases, you don't really have your actual profitability go down. In fact, your profitability goes up the more price increases, because no matter what, there's always going to be the majority of people who won't want to spend a single dollar on your service or business. There's going to be a mid-range that will spend a little bit, and then there's going to be that small percentage that will spend a lot of money. So just focus on the small percentage that will spend a lot of money as your way to get people into the door, and you'll be much more profitable, because those people, they're very price flexible, right? So they might be willing to pay $9.97. More of them will be able to even pay like more than that. So it's kind of like, if I was a web hosting company, what I would think about is, hey, can I create a blogging course? Let's say, you know, your customers are mainly bloggers, people running blogging websites, and then bundle in 6 months of web hosting, right? Or a year of web hosting, and then sell that for maybe $4.97 or $9.97, where it's going to be a lot easier to make upfront profit. Because as I mentioned, it's like, if you don't have venture capital, how are you going to support that cash flow? Even if your ROI is 4X, right? Because you keep them on for 2 years, you spend 6 months of the acquisition, you know, their lifetime value on getting a customer. How are you going to afford that 6 months on it? Because you're paying, you know, basically 6 months, and you got to wait 6 months for that. So because of that, you got to find a way to collect more of the cash upfront. And that's kind of the secret of making kind of YouTube ads work, is collect more money upfront so you can afford it, or get venture capital. And then in that case, then it becomes a lot easier as well, right? But if you don't want venture capital, if you don't want to give away a big portion of your business, you got to get creative and think about, like, what can I offer my customers that they're going to be willing to pay me a lot more money upfront, feel good about it, and then long-term stay with me and, you know, bring in a lot more revenue in the long-term as well, but so that you're not losing money upfront. Making money upfront is better.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's some great advice. And I can see, really, it's just about that offer. Even if you're in a hyper-competitive niche, if you bundle the right offer, it can be very attractive to, you know, more people, because if you're just going to go out there just with your, like you said, a $12 a month hosting plan, you know, tons of competitors and all these bigger companies, like you said, the HostGators, you know, they've got plans for $4 a month, things like that. And it's really hard to compete with that. And the bottom line is the cost that it's going to take you to acquire those customers and keep them, and for you to be able to recoup your ad costs, your ad spend. It could take your time, and it's can be a little risky because there's always the churn as well with these service-based companies. So yeah, great tip. Definitely some awesome advice there. Now, as far as the types of ads, this is always kind of, a pain point for any e-commerce business that is trying to do any type of digital advertising, is that content. You know, what do you come up with? What should be in that content? What are some suggestions for, you know, finding that right type of ad content that's going to, you know, work well with your offer, and then also, you know, be attractive and you really get you, I guess you could say, the most bang for your buck? What are some different types of content that businesses or that have performed well lately?
So if you're selling, let's say, a physical product, right? Let's say you're an e-commerce brand selling a physical product. What you need to understand is you need to both demonstrate your product and show it being used, or show the actual kind of visual value of it, because people understand things visually, but also have a story, basically a narration that actually isn't just your product being shown, right? Like, you actually need to talk to the customer, tell them that, hey, this is the pain point we're trying to solve, and this is how this product solves it. Okay. So typically having a guide or a narrator or a hero character helps really well in these e-commerce videos, right? So if you look at the best e-commerce ads out there, typically they do have their live action, and they have some sort of funny character, and maybe a potentially a second character as well, who might be the person the end user kind of identifies with, right? The person using the product. And then there's like the guide, the savior, the guy who basically shows them, hey, this is the solution to your problem. So with that, that's a really important thing to keep in mind, is you do need to think about that. Now, you can get away with doing voiceover video ads where you just take footage and you edit it in with a voiceover. That's something that you can do for a couple $100s. And if you have a lot of video footage lying around, that can actually work well. But one thing to keep in mind typically is the best e-commerce video ads typically will be live action, right? Now, that doesn't mean you need to start with them. You can start with a voiceover video ad and take some footage, edit it in, and you'll have something that works. Another tip I have for e-commerce companies is you just need to look at what works, right? Because it's very hard to describe what works over a podcast, because you actually need to see it. So my recommendation for that is I use this free tool called vidtao.com. So vidtao.com. And basically you can just go in there and look up ads, right? So just look up whatever industry you want to look at, right? So let's say you're in the skincare industry, start looking up skincare YouTube ads. And usually the ones with the most views are the ones that are working. So after watching four or five, you can get a good idea of the pacing, what's working, what's not working, as that will depend on the industry. Now, in terms of tips that work for everybody, is typically you want to grab their attention with a very strong hook right at the beginning of the video. So that needs to be either a controversial statement or some sort of action. So an example of this is one of our clients, they sell shoes that are indestructible. And what we did with their ad is literally have the hook of the ad be a brick being dropped on this guy while he's wearing a shoe, right? And typically you think a brick being dropped on your shoe is going to be extremely painful, but you know, in this case, it was proven otherwise. So that's in hook, right? That's something that grabs attention from the get-go, because you have 5 seconds to really get their attention before they can hit the skip button. So doing that hook is going to help immensely. After that, you want to actually explain what it is that you're doing with your product, right? What are the pain points you're solving for? Introduce them to the product, introduce them to your brand and why they should trust you. So it could be something like, hey, yeah, we're in, let's say, a mattress company that has helped over 50,000 people sleep better and been featured by Wirecutter as the top, you know, mattress in 2021, right? Like, having some level of basically credibility building early on in the ad can help. Now, you do want to have a lot of demonstration in there showing how the product actually works, walking them through all the major basically benefits and the unique mechanism, if there is a unique mechanism for the product, which, you know, if you're selling a product, you definitely should have some sort of unique mechanism that makes your product work better than other products. Mm-hmm. And you also should have customer reviews, testimonials in there at some point. You want to have a couple of different call to actions where you tell them, hey, click the link above or below to go to our website to basically purchase this. Obviously, if you have some sort of discount that you can give them or some sort of special promo or additional, let's say, add-on that they get on mm-hmm. top of that, that's beneficial too. But that's basically the rough outline of an ad, right? Like these elements can kind of be moved around, but typically you'll want to have, basically demonstration of the product, obviously the hook at the right at the beginning. You want to have mm-hmm. the social proof and credibility, and two call to actions where one of them is earlier in the ad, perhaps 30 seconds to a minute in, and a second one is perhaps a couple minutes in. As for length, ads can be anywhere from a minute long. We've had ads that have performed really well for selling bras that have been only 50 seconds long, while other ads are typically 2-3 minutes long. But typically mm-hmm. we see 1 to 2.5 minutes being the golden spot. And then mm-hmm. obviously when we have a winning variation of an ad, we'll try a shorter version and a longer version. So we'll cut it down to try making a 45-50 second version, see how that performs, or we'll add stuff to it to try making a 4-5 minute version where maybe we'll have some video testimonials from customers spliced in. Maybe we'll basically take in other footage and add that in. So mm-hmm. the goal is to basically, once we have something that's working, try out different lengths of the ad, try out different hooks. So we'll always shoot different hooks and different attention grabbers at the beginning, and then we'll edit that in with the main body of the ad. So that maybe have three mm-hmm. or four different hooks. And then once you have all of these, you have a very high chance of success, because now instead of just testing one ad with mm-hmm. three different length variations with four different hooks, that same kind of footage that you shot at in one kind of for one ad for one shoot, you literally mm-hmm. have 12 variations now that you can play with.
Okay. Gotcha. Yeah. And then that's something you can rotate and then, you know, see which performs the best. Thank you for sharing that detailed breakdown of the content and kind of what should be in it. Because like I said, I think it's a real pain point for businesses because, you know, there's something they want to do, but they don't really know, you know, kind of really what should be in the meat of it. Now, let's say there's some e-commerce businesses that are listening. They say, you know, all of this sounds good. They can go through, do the research. They can check out the site that you mentioned, the VidTal, take a look at some of their competitors' ads. And let's say they have an idea of really what they want, and they task somebody on their marketing team to, you know, to come up with all this. Is this something, are these ads something that can be done, you know, entirely in-house, fairly affordably, or Do the creation of these, does it really have to be outsourced? What do you think is the best course of action as far as creating these?
So it depends on the ads. If it's just a simple voiceover with taking some of your footage and splicing it together, you can mm-hmm. hire an editor, or if you have an in-house editor, use them. Now, mm-hmm. if you're talking about a live action ad, if you have a production team, which most businesses don't, then yeah, you can do it in-house. But most likely what you'll have to do is find a production partner. So it's kind of like what we had to do is essentially build a Rolodex of production partners. So whenever we have clients who want an ad shot, we would just go to our partners and basically figure out, which, let's say we know this video agency has done really good work in this niche before. Mm-hmm. We pair them up and we project manage it and take care of the whole process. So essentially, if you don't have like that, you just go and interview a bunch of agencies, look at their work, and hire one of them. But as I said, to get started, you can just start with taking your raw footage, right? Any footage you already have, combining mm-hmm. it with a video editor. Now if you're the creative type, you can try shooting your own ad, right? Like mm-hmm. that's also a possibility. I've seen people shoot their own ads and do well. Obviously, if you're selling a software or a course, it's a lot easier because with the software, you can basically just have a talking head on camera, like I'm talking on the camera right now, with some mm-hmm. screen share footage of your software and what it does. And that's good enough, right? With courses, same thing. You can just have a talking head on camera going over what your training teaches them. Now, if you're selling an e-commerce product, you actually are selling something physical. And a big mm-hmm. part of that is the visual side, right? People buy physical products. And a big part of that is I'm not going to buy something that's presented in an ugly manner, right? It's just, mm-hmm. it doesn't build trust. Especially if you're selling something that's healthcare related, et cetera, you really do need that production value where if somebody sees a really snazzy ad, they kind of assume that, okay, this is legitimate, this is a company that's real, versus kind of a lower quality ad. So that's something to keep in mind where with e-commerce, it is a little bit more of a barrier to really get the ads working, but it's really worth it if you're at the point where, you know, you have a proven product, you're scaling with Facebook ads. Let's say you're doing $80,000 to $100,000 a month already, and you want to start scaling your sales with YouTube ads and really start building a stronger acquisition system that's not just reliant on Facebook ads. Now, on the other hand, if you're just starting out, you're doing $5,000 a month, it might be better to stick to Facebook until you can grow to maybe $50,000-$60,000 a month and then start scaling. Now, I'm not saying this is something you have to do and follow, but, and it's going to depend on you, right? Like somebody who's got a video production background who can shoot their own ads, they can launch an ad on YouTube, and even if their brand is super small, and do it really well, right? Yeah. But on the other hand, if video is something you haven't done well before, then it makes sense to start with something like Facebook ads where you can use images and so on, build up some revenue, and then from there go into YouTube when you have the ability to invest a couple $1,000s into getting a proper shoot done with a videographer.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, that's a good suggestion, because those the other platforms like the Facebook, where you can create the little smaller things that you can use that to really kind of start creating your messaging, testing out different things, and you know, then go from there to the YouTube and then create more of a longer form type of ad. So yeah, that's definitely a great tip where those other platforms can be used more as a testing bed. Well, Shash, you know, as we get ready to wrap things up, I'm always interested to find out about specific companies that have done some of these types of e-commerce marketing strategies. So are there any particular companies that you guys have either worked with or that you're familiar with in general that have had some real success utilizing YouTube advertising? And what are some specific things that they've done that have really done well?
Yeah, so we worked with a client that, as I mentioned, the shoes. We did over $1.1 million in revenue with YouTube ads for them at a 2.24x return on ad spend. Which was significantly better than their Facebook ads return on ad spend as well. And that was basically down to us just testing creatives, working with a agency to really just create many variations of different angles and hooks. And ultimately, one ad just really did extremely well. And that's what we've discovered is most of your ads are not going to do that well. But once you find that hero ad, your account will scale and it will just do extremely well. So that's really important to figure out. And yeah, we've had a lot of students do well with the e-commerce as well. So one of our coaching clients, Mike, he is in a healthcare niche and he's done, I think last year he did a couple million with YouTube ads. I think I talked, like I interviewed him for my YouTube channel. You can look it up if like it's, I'll send you a link to my YouTube channel, post it in there. But he basically just went from 30K to 300K a month with YouTube ads selling healthcare. So that was another case. We've obviously helped that bra company do almost $1 million. So we've had a fair bit of experience with physical products. We've also done a lot of software, a lot of courses, a lot of various kind of different things with YouTube ads. And I definitely say the biggest that we've done is basically the information niche, where we probably generated north of $20 million in that niche. But e-commerce has been a lot of fun too whenever we've worked on e-commerce projects. It's just always been such a blast to scale those e-commerce products.
Right, right. Well, yeah, thank you for sharing that, Shash. I appreciate that. It's always good to, you know, see some real world examples of people that are really having success with these tactics. So what we'll do is in the show notes as well as in the transcript, we'll once you provide me with that link to company that you worked with, we'll include that there so people can kind of check them out, see what they've done. And like I said, it's been awesome having you on. I have learned a lot today for sure. I was kind of feverishly trying to take some notes here to relay some things to our marketing and advertising team, because we have done some things in the past on YouTube, but we're looking to take some things to the next level. Actually, we have a digital marketing course actually that we just recently launched, and I think YouTube bundling may be a way to go with that. So I'm definitely going to bring back some ideas to our team and see how that works for us. So lastly, before we let you go, I'm always interested to see a little bit more about our guests that we have on, just so our audience can get to know you a little bit better, if you don't mind sharing one closing fun fact about yourself that you think people will be interested to know.
I like surfing. Okay. That's my biggest hobby. Unfortunately, I'm in a landlocked city right now in Poland. Right. So I'm not doing much surfing right now, but that's like my biggest hobby.
Okay. That's awesome. That's awesome, man. Yeah, that's one thing. Believe it or not, I've been in Florida for 10 years now, and I haven't taken one surfing lesson yet. That's one thing that's down on my list to do. I haven't done it, but I will soon for sure. It's good to know that you're in it. Any surfing tips for a first time surfer when I do get out there?
Know how to swim.
Yeah, well, I got that down. That's a check. Yeah, for sure. I definitely know how to swim.
Hold your breath.
That too. Okay. Gotcha. All right. I guess I got to work on my breath holding. Well, yeah, thank you for sharing that. I appreciate you sharing that fun fact. And, lastly, before we let you go, if any of our listeners or viewers want to reach out to you and pick your brain anymore about YouTube advertising, what is the best way for them to reach you?
Yeah, so our agency website is linxdigitalagency.com. I'll have a link to that. And I'll also shoot over a link to our YouTube channel, Shash Singh, on YouTube. So that's a really great place where there's a ton of free video tutorials. We're like releasing at this point. This week, we're starting to do 5 times a week. So we got various members of the team, including me, shooting videos showing you how to set up YouTube ad campaigns, strategy, creatives, everything. So I highly recommend checking out the YouTube channel.
Okay, great. Thank you for sharing that. And I encourage our listeners to take advantage of all of those free resources that you guys have on your YouTube channel. And I'll definitely be sure to do that myself. So it's been a pleasure once again, Shash, speaking to you today. And it was awesome having you on the Ecommerce Marketing Podcast.
Likewise. Thank you so much for having me on here.
No problem.
Thank you for listening to the Ecommerce Marketing Podcast. If you've enjoyed this episode, be sure to rate, review, subscribe, and share it with everyone you know. Are you looking to take your digital marketing to the next level, but are tired of weeding through countless YouTube videos with unproven and untrusted marketing strategies? Well, we have the answer for you. The More Sales Every Month online digital marketing course. In this information-packed course, you will learn effective keyword research, link building, content marketing, and much more to attract and convert your site visitors into paying customers. Just go to moresaleseverymonth.com and sign up today for a low one-time fee. In addition to this power-packed course, if you would like to get access to a growing repository of digital marketing articles, PDFs, and ebooks, check out getosi.com/resources and opt in to get full access to our library of priceless marketing information to help you take your digital marketing to the next level.